Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Brighty of the Grand Canyon by Marguerite Henry, narrated by John McDonough.
Foreword. This is the story of a little lone burro who lived in the Grand Canyon of Arizona. An old prospector found him running wild along Bright Angel Creek that tumbles down the north wall of the canyon into the Colorado River. The prospector roped and gentled him, but then he gave him his freedom. Instead of hobbles or pickets, he held on to him by the invisible cord of friendship, flapjacks shared and small talk around the campfire, and a warm hand scratching the itchy places on his back. In return, the burro carried the prospector's pick and pan, and even packed water for him. The rest of the time was his own. He was free to browse or to splash in the creek, or just to sit dog-fashion, dozing in the sun. After the prospector died, Brighty became a wild spirit again. He migrated like a bird. In winter, all alone, he roamed the warm inner reaches of the canyon, where snow never falls. But in summer, he hightailed it to the rim, to live in the cool mountain meadows of the Kaibab Forest. Soon, men began using the trail he made, explorers and rangers, artists and tourists. Brighty greeted them with hearty brays, took potluck with them, and enjoyed their company. That is, until they tried to hobble him. Then he went bounding off, hee-hawing at their foolishness. But in spite of this, or perhaps because of it, men loved him, respected him, and envied him. He became their symbol of a joyous way of life. To Brighty, then, my gratefulness for luring me to the Grand Canyon. May his wild, free spirit forever call men to his haunts. And on still summer nights, may they hear, as I did, his faraway voice singing to the moon. Brighty's World. A shaggy young burro lay asleep in the gray dust of the canyon trail. Except for the slow heaving of his sides and an occasional flick of an ear, he seemed part of the dust and the ageless limestone that rose in great towering battlements behind him. The sun had been shining fiercely on his belly and now began climbing up over his sides, then slowly up the canyon wall. But for a long time, the rocks held their heat and the solitary figure dozed on. A ground squirrel peered out from a chink in the wall, watching a moment with friendly eyes, then dived back where it came from. A cottontail rabbit played hop, skip, and jump around him, but nothing disturbed the little gray lump, not even a nuthatch hammering away at a juniper tree. It was the wind, an uprising current of wind from the depths of the canyon, that finally aroused him. It whirled up his nose and down his ears, tickling him awake. With a grunting sigh, he began rolling, and with each turn just missed falling off his ledge into Bright Angel Creek, hundreds of feet below. Now he sat up on his haunches, squirming his back against the rough, warm limestone. He gave a luxurious yawn and gazed at the opposite wall as if in search of some creature like himself. But there was only rock, rising sheer and lonely to the sky. He stretched his forelegs, and then he was up, shaking the dust from his coat. Over the ledge, a few spears of bunch grass grew in a crevice. He leaned out into space and cropped them, jaws swinging sideways as he chewed, while his eyes, from under their thatched roof of hair, looked out over his world. It was a world of rock piled up and up, layer on layer to the sky, and down to the Colorado River, far below. Slowly, as if balancing the weight of his great ears, the little fellow swung his head around to follow the winding river. His eyes suddenly fixed on a tiny white spot, and at sight of it he opened wide his jaws, swelled out his nostrils, and began braying. Yee-aw! 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 Instantly the canyon took up the cry. South wall to north and back again it banged and bounced the bray until there was nothing left of it. The burro waited, listening. His ears probed the white spot as if to pull something out of it. There it was, an answering sound, a bellowing hello, almost as big and brassy as his own. It set the little burro into action. Down the trail he plunged, zigzagging from ledge to ledge, ears flopping, tail swinging, hoofs toe-dancing the narrow path. Once on his way, a kind of momentum took hold of him, and he fairly flew, rounding one cliff only to face another. Time and again he crossed Bright Angel Creek, a foaming mountain stream that tumbled downward to the river. For yards and yards he walked in its bed, picking his way around the glossy boulders. But he neither drank nor played in the water. Only once did he stop to study his goal. The white spot had grown to a tent, and nearby, campfire smoke was curling upward. Satisfied, he plunged on again, always traveling within sight and sound of the busy creek. The afternoon was late, and purple shadows were spilling down the canyon walls when he came at last upon the source of the smoke. An old, old prospector, with flowing white hair, was piling driftwood on a fire. And beside the fire stood an iron skillet and a bowl of yellow batter. A Stranger in the Canyon. Stepping softly in the sand, the burro sneaked behind the prospector and playfully butted him up from his crouching position. The old man spun around, his face lighting with joy. "Brighty!" he shouted happily. "You little old pussyfooter! You e'enamost upset the batter, to say nothing of me myself." He let the burro nuzzle his grizzly beard. "'Tain't hay!" he howled with laughter. He laid more driftwood on the fire, then turned and began scratching Brighty, starting with the scruff of mane and kneading down the dark stripe along his back. "Feller," he thundered above the river's roar, "you sure got an alarm clock in your head. Tan my hide if you don't arrive exactly at supper time. It's flapjacks tonight, see? Got the batter all done. Ain't it nice and bubbly?" The burro began nosing the batter. "Oh, no, you don't." The old man pushed the burro's face out of the bowl. "You just wait till I flap 'em. Me and you's goin' to celebrate tonight." He spooned lard into the skillet, and while it was melting, pulled some blue-flecked stones from his pocket and held them under Brighty's nose. "Sniff 'em," he urged. "Sniff 'em good. Where they come from, they's more. A hull bluish-green vein of the stuff. And if I could just find somebody to help dig it up, then me and you could pack it out." The burro's ears swung back and forth, asking for more talk. "Yep, Bright Angel, you and me's struck it rich. We've found us enough copper ore to last till kingdom come, and maybe after." He took off his black hat and let the wind comb his hair. "We'll call our diggings the Little Mimi for my sister's gal." "It's like this, Brighty," he explained as he stooped to pick up a fallen blue jay's feather. My kid's sister had only the one gal, Mimi, and she's crippled in the legs. He stuck the feather in his hat band and smoothed it out. Mimi's purty as an angel, eyes blue as lupin, and curls the color of wood shavings. Now, Brighty, he said, his face shining with plans, with the money from the ore, we'll buy her a wheelchair so she can go scootin' through life like a butterfly. He paused to add more lard to the skillet. As for ye, young feller, when the money rolls in, I'll buy ye all kinds of doodads, a tinkly bell for your neck, and a shade hat with holes for your ears, and some flea shoe powder, and... Brighty wheeled around, looking, smelling, listening. Hey, hark to me instead of the night noises. It's just the river sawing away at the rocks, or some old coyote tuning up. But the burro's ears were prying into the night, and his breath snorting in his nose. Humph! Don't hear a thing myself. The old man poured two mounds of batter into the skillet. Could be our ring-tailed cat sharpening her toenails on a piece of drift, he said. And then, all at once, the prospector caught movement. The tall figure of a man loomed in the dark. He stalked slowly toward the fire, a dead beaver dangling from one hand.
"Reckon I scared you,"
the man grunted. His voice sounded rusty, as if it had not been used for a long time. The prospector stroked the burro's neck, trying to quiet him. "Brighty here told me you was coming, but I wouldn't believe him." Motionless, except for his fingers twirling the beaver, the stranger sized up the prospector. Then his eyes looked past him to the tent, where a pick and a pan stood outlined against the white canvas. The sweet smell of hot cakes filled the air, and the old man dropped a third spoonful of batter on the skillet.
"In the shock of seeing a human being," he said, "I mighty near forgot to cook for three mouths instead of two. Would you believe it, stranger? I ain't seen a living soul except Uncle Jimmy Owen and Brighty here for upwards of 6 months. I'm mighty glad to meet you."
He waited for a "glad to meet you, too." When none came, he went on, his hand still quieting Brighty.
"My name's Hezekiah Appleyard, but don't nobody call me by that handle. What's yours?"
The stranger moved in closer. The firelight made his small black eyes and black beard gleam, and it picked out the red kerchief around his neck and splashed red on his face.
"Name's Irons," he said. "Jake Irons, beaver trapper."
"Now that's what I calls a good, short, sensible handle," the old man replied. "Folks calls me old-timer. When I first heard it, I looks around quick to see if some old guy's behind me. When I seen they's referring to me, my hackles riz up."
He faced around to the fire and turned the hissing flapjacks.
"I'm used to the label now. Fact is, I sort of like it. Makes me feel I'm a sure-enough canyon man."
The hard black eyes were on the cakes.
"Ye needn't just stand there gawping, Irons. Come, share our chuck. It'll be kind of nice to listen to man talk for a change, though Brighty here's got a mighty sweet song for a burro."
"Don't mind if I do,"
the stranger smiled, but only with his lips. His black beard parted briefly, flashing two gold teeth, very shiny. The old man could not help admiring them.
"I come down here to the canyon seeking gold," he said, "but I guess gold ain't the onliest way to get rich."
The pin eyes gave the prospector a sly glance. Then, going over to a flat rock, Iron slapped down the beaver and took out his hunting knife.
"Go ahead, skin out your beaver," Old Timer said. "But don't ye flaunt the smell in front of Brighty. He don't like hot meat, nor meat of any kind for that matter."
Jake Irons knelt in the sand and with nimble fingers skinned the beaver, setting aside the choice bits of meat. Before anyone could say scat, a ring-tailed cat leaped up on the rock and made off with the liver.
"Ain't she quick, though?"
The old man slapped his thigh in admiration.
"Her name's Wait a Minute, 'cause she never does. Oh, well, ye still got the pelt, and that's what you're after."
Muttering to himself, Jake Irons stretched the beaver skin, using stones to hold it in place. As he turned around, he almost bumped into Brighty, who stood with hindquarters hunched, threatening to let his heels fly.
"Reckon he's just a mite jealous about sharing his supper," the old man laughed. "Leastwise, that's what I hope."
Blue-flecked rocks. When the cakes were richly browned, the old man stacked a plate for Jake Irons and handed him a jug of honey. Then he fanned a single cake in the air to cool and sprinkled it generously with sugar. He smiled sheepishly.
"Brighty likes sugar better'n honey," he explained. "'Tain't so slobbery."
As the trapper watched, Brighty took the rolled pancake from the old man's hand and began chewing rhythmically, thoughtfully.
"You two always dine on cakes and honey?" Irons asked. The note of scorn in his voice was lost to Old Timer.
"Only when we're celebrating, stranger. And now, how about sampling a cup of my coffee? Uncle Jim says it's black as a thief's heart."
Jake Irons glanced up sharply, trying to read the old man's thoughts. But Hezekiah Appleyard was not even looking his way. Irons flashed an ugly grin.
"I like my coffee black as that," he retorted.
The two men in the burro finished their supper in silence, while a handful of stars pricked holes in the sky. After a while, the old prospector took a gold watch from his pocket and began winding it with a little gold key.
"'Tain't but 7," he said, winding. "I'll pile more wood on the fire, and how about us chinning some before bedding down?"
"Much obliged, Old Timer. But soon as the moon shines over the brink, I'm crossing the river and heading up to the south rim. By the way," he asked, making his voice sound casual, "what you celebrating?"
The old man held his tongue, thinking. He picked up a sharp-edged stone and began cleaning Brighty's hoofs, as though he could clear his thoughts at the same time. He failed to see that the stone he was using for a hoof pick was veined with blue. But Iron's quick eyes caught the telltale color of copper ore. His mind began racing.
"Now don't you bother spilling your secrets to me, Old Timer," he wheedled. "It's just like I said. I'm topping out of this black pit, and I don't figure to come back. Not ever. I'm tired trapping. Ain't enough beaver in these waters to keep me in grub."
The old man was only half listening. He was eyeing the lean, hard body, noticing the sleeve stretched tight over the bulge of muscle, the big, broad-fingered hands with their broken fingernails, the solid legs encased in their puttees.
"You mean you're done trapping and out of work?" he asked.
"That's exactly what I mean. I ain't one to complain, but tonight's the first square meal I've had in weeks. And when I saw your cozy camp with the critter and all, right away I says to myself, here's a man I can trust."
Old Timer looked all around, as if to make certain they were alone.
"If you're really done trapping," he cried, "maybe you could work for me. I need a young muscly feller, 'cause—" his voice pitched high as a boy's— "'cause me and Brighty's found an extraordinary vein of ore."
Jake Iron smiled to himself at how neatly his flattery had worked.
"Yep," the whitehead nodded. "With you and me to dig and Brighty to pack the stuff out, us three can get rich quick. You see, I got a sister with a crippled youngster, and sick folks needs lots of money."
"Yeah, I know," Irons said sarcastically. "You're just the kind to give the stuff away."
Mistaking the mockery for approval, the old man sat down, leaning happily against Brighty.
"Ye'll do, Jake Irons."
His eyes were far away and joyous.
"Ye'll do as a partner in the little Mimi mine."
For a long moment, the muffled roar of the river filled in the silence, and somewhere down the canyon, a coyote howled.
"Even by starlight, ye'll see how rich the stuff is."
Hoisting himself up, the old man moved nearer and spilled the blue-flecked rocks into greedy, outstretched hands.
"Here, study on 'em, feller."
Over and over, Irons turned the nuggets in his hand. Then he made a wide circuit around Brighty and fed the fire the better to see.
"Where'd you find these?"
he asked, trying to hide the eagerness in his voice.
"Well, friend, me and Brighty was dawdling along, loafing and poking along down close to the Colorado, when we spied us one of them horny toads."
"And then?"
"Then Brighty flips this toad over with his little old mealy nose, and underneath, guess what?"
Without waiting for Irons to guess, the old man went on.
"There, underneath, was one of them blue-green rocks. 'Twas only a broken-off lump, but I figured where there's one, there's more."
"Yeah, like mice."
"Exactly. And I looks up overhead, and I sees some more of this color in an overhang of rock. And me and Brighty forgets the horny toad, and I begins a-digging and a-digging. Got so feverish, I hardly stopped for meals. If it hadn't been for Brighty bellerin' at sundown, I'd like to starve to death."
Jake Irons returned the nuggets and flopped down in the sand on the other side of the fire.
"Lots of veins look good to begin with," he said, "but they pinch off to nothing."
"You're right. Most of 'em does, but not this one. No siree. It got bigger and bigger the further I dug. Only just today was I certain sure. Come morning, I'll take ye in the tunnel and show ye."
He pointed north.
"'Tain't far, just over there a piece. Wait till you see the tree ladder I built up to the tunnel. She swings out a bit over the river, but she's stout enough."
Jake Irons plucked at his beard, figuring a way to accept the invitation and seem casual about it.
"I see you got a tent big enough for two," he said at last. "And it's been a long time since I slept out of the wind. Besides," he added, looking toward the river, "it'd be risky trying to cross on that cableway in the dark. Guess I'll stay till morning anyway." "But your burro," he hesitated, "does he hug camp all night?"
"You're dern tootin', he does, and it makes me mighty proud. Until I chanced on this here copper mine, I had only two things I took pride in. One was my grandpap's gold watch with the gold key to wind it, and the other's Brighty. Found the little feller running wild along Bright Angel Creek."
"So you named him Bright Angel, him being so bright, I suppose."
"Yep, only he weren't no Bright Angel at the time. Great horns, but he was a sight. Some porcupine had made a pincushion out of his face."
The old man clapped Brighty's rump.
"'Member, feller? If I hadn't come along about then and roped ye and pulled out the quills with my pliers, ye'd have gone under for sure." Chuckling, the prospector turned now to Jake Irons. "Guess he was so hungry and hurted, he figured I was his best friend." Irons's eyes avoided Brighty, and he strove to keep the contempt out of his voice.
"And so he's latched onto you ever since, I take it?"
The white head nodded. "'Cept for summer times. You see, Irons, he's like a migrator bird. Winters, he lives down here in the canyon where it's warm, and summers, he hightails it up to the north rim where it's cool. You know," he went on, leaning back against Brighty, "'twas him that made the trail all the way up to the north rim. And mind ye, Irons, that wall is so steep, he couldn't go the short way. He had to zig and zag. It's over 21 miles to the top." The old man stretched his legs and dug his heels in the sand. "If ever you decides to top out north instead of south, Brighty here knows the way. Don't forget that. And if he's a mind to, he can pack a pick and pan as nice as you please."
"You don't say." Jake Irons' eyes glinted in the firelight.
"But I do say. And what's more, Brighty knows character. If ever he out and out kicks a man, there's a man can't be trusted. Once, when we went to town, Brighty near kicked a barber up on the chandelier. Next I heard about him, that haircutter feller was serving time for thieving."
The trapper went over to feel his beaver skin, but his mind was listening.
"Now, on the other hand," old-timer went on, "take Uncle Jimmy Owen up on the north rim. Know him, son?"
"Just by hearsay," Irons answered. "He's the government lion hunter, ain't he?"
"Yeah, he's the one. Well, Brighty's got good reason to mistrust Uncle Jimmy, because he smells to high heaven of lions, and anyone knows a burro hates lions worser than work. But does he hate Uncle Jimmy?"
"Don't he?"
"Indeed he no. He sidles up to him to get his back scratched, same as he does to me. Like I say, Brighty knows character, even when it's wrapped up in lion smell. Why, if an I was to die tonight, Uncle Jimmy'd step right into my boots, fur as Brighty goes, right into my boots."
Irons sharpened his knife blade on a rock, thinking. He hardly heard the next words.
"You see," old-timer was saying, "Uncle Jimmy understands, just like I do, that Brighty's a free spirit. Seems like he's got to be free to breathe."
The talk petered out and the fire burned low. Yawning, the two men went into the tent and settled down for the night, the old man on his cot, the young man wrapped in his blanket. Between them, the big gold watch hung from the ridgepole, ticking the minutes away.
Goodbye, old-timer. The night was noiseless, except for the wind and the river. A few sparks gleamed in the fire like fallen stars. Brighty edged closer to the dying glow. The sand felt warm and scratchy to his skin as he lay squirming on his back, his hoofs pawing at the chink of sky between the canyon walls. After a time, the moon showed itself, and gradually, very gradually, began whitewashing rocks and promontories. It whitened Brighty's belly, too, and his nose, as he lay blinking upward. At last, he snuggled into the nest he had made in the sand. He closed his eyes and let sleep claim him while the wind played with his scraggly mane. All night long, the wind and the river went on about their business, sweeping down the canyon. Sounds came through Brighty's sleep, the voices of coyotes and foxes, and the occasional ringing sound of a rock tumbling from crag to crag. But all of this was canyon music to Brighty, and he slept on in the friendly darkness. Toward morning, his thirst awakened him, and he took off for Bright Angel Creek, a small gray shadow winding among the deeper shadows of morning. There was burrow brush on his way, and he stopped to browse here and there until his thirst pulled him on to the chattering creek. He waded far upstream, up where the water flowed so clear he could see trout darting under the rocks. He drank his fill, not in one long draught, but a little here, then up the creek away, and another mouthful, until he was satisfied. Sometimes he stood quite still, letting the water foam and feather around his legs. But more often he got into a rough-and-tumble fight with it, pawing madly until he churned whirlpools and eddies. Then he stood over it like a victor, blowing and snorting, as he watched the sand settle to the bottom again. Bright Angel Creek seemed to flow especially for him, to quench his thirst and wash his feet, and to grow willows and grasses that stayed green for him, no matter what. Morning passed. The whole day passed, while Brighty played in the creek and browsed alongside it. Only occasionally he clambered over the rocks and up the stern granite walls to get away from its gushing chatter, but always he hurried back as to an old friend. With the coming of twilight, however, the babble of the creek seemed idle nonsense. He felt a need for human company. Somewhere in the shadows far below, a nice old man would be stirring biscuits or hotcakes. A hunger and a longing came to him, and he clattered out upon the rocks to a parapet that looked down on the campsite. There, he spotted the white tent, no bigger than a deer tail. He worked himself into a bray that sounded loud and clear. When the last echo had died, he waited, listening. But there was no answer. He brayed again, louder, fuller, longer, and again he waited for the answering hello. But again there was none, none at all. Only the echoes growing fainter and fainter, until at last they were swallowed up by silence. Even with no answer, habit was strong in him. He had to get to camp. For the next
hour. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.